about ongoing events in their respective districts? Nope? Okay. So first, we're going to have a presentation by the Ending Epidemic Task Force on the blueprint for ending the epidemic, an initiative by New York State to reduce HIV infections and AIDS deaths. Charles King, CEO of Housing Works, will be making the presentation.
Thank you very much, and thank you for your attention. I appreciate you have a full agenda, so I'll be very brief. Valerie Menis, who is our associate for New York City Community Mobilization, is handing out some materials that I hope you will take back to your respective community boards and share those materials. As some of you might well know, we started a campaign 3 years ago to make New York State the first jurisdiction anywhere in the world to end AIDS as an epidemic. With the result that on June 29th, 2014, Governor Cuomo committed to exactly that, and very specifically to ending AIDS as an epidemic in New York State by 2020. With some further advocacy, he appointed a task force last October. That task force developed a blueprint for how we would go about ending AIDS as an epidemic in New York State by 2020, and on April 29th, the governor fully embraced that blueprint. I was privileged to co-chair the task force that developed the blueprint, and am also chairing the community coalition that is working with the state to implement the blueprint. The blueprint is based on three very simple prongs that are really important. One is identifying every single person who's living with the virus in New York State, getting them into care, and getting them onto treatment. The second is to ensure that everyone who is HIV positive and knows their status is not only in treatment, but is 100% virally suppressed. There have been some recent studies that have demonstrated that if somebody is completely virally suppressed, if they start on medication as soon as they find out they're HIV positive and get completely virally suppressed, they cannot transmit the virus to anyone else. And not only that, but the sooner they start on treatment, the more likely it is they will live a normal and healthy life, even though we still don't have a cure or the ability to eradicate the virus. And the third prong is scaling up a new intervention. It's called pre-exposure prophylaxis, PrEP. Gilead makes a pill, Truvada, that if a person takes it every single day, a minimum of 4 times a week, they cannot become infected with HIV. They're completely protected from HIV infection. And so the core of the blueprint is looking at how we fully implement these three interventions, and at the same time provide people with housing, with vocational opportunity, all the things that people living with HIV or at risk of HIV need to live their lives whole. I've actually been traveling around the state for the last couple of months, and just 2 weeks ago we held in this very room, hosted by the borough president, a half-day summit where we organized a task force. There were over 100 people present, where we organized a task force to look at how we would implement the blueprint here in Brooklyn. One of the things that we thought was very important to do was to get out of the silo of just the folk who are living with HIV, the folk who are working with people with HIV, to let communities know that we really are living right now with the possibility of ending the AIDS epidemic, something that, as you all know, has been something that New York has been the epicenter of for the last 30 years. Just a couple of points in terms of how far we've come. In the height of the epidemic in the 90s, if you remember back, we had 15,000 infections every year, 15,000 new infections. We're now down to less than 3,000 new infections a year. We had 500 perinatal infections every year in New York State. This year, for the first time ever, we have gotten to the month of October. We have not had a single perinatal infection in the entire state. Used to be we had 7,500 new infections associated with injection drug use every year in New York State. This last year, we had less than 100. new infections associated with injection drug use. Where we still haven't really cracked the nut is men who have sex with men, particularly young men of color, black men, Latino, who are having sex with men, and transgender folk. And that's a big focus of our attention. With that, one of the reasons why we wanted to be able to present it to the Borough Board is because what we would really love is for each one of you to go back to your community boards, develop a resolution in support of full implementation of the blueprint that calls on the governor and the mayor of New York City. 80% of the state's epidemic is in our city. It calls on those two officials to lead the way in fully funding the effort to end the epidemic so we can actually accomplish that goal. In the interest of time, I'll stop there. I'm more than happy to take any questions. I've asked Valerie to give all of you my business card if you're interested in working to develop a resolution. We've already had some community boards in Manhattan pass resolutions to this effect. We'd be happy to share that information with you and work with you to do that, but also figure out how to connect your work with work of organizations who are working in your respective communities to advance in the epidemic. Thank you.
Thank you, Charles. Are there any questions from any members of the Borough Board at this time? Could you provide a copy of the resolution to us as well so we can circulate all members?
We will absolutely provide you with the draft resolution that you can circulate. Very much appreciate it.
Are there any other questions before? Okay, great. Thank you very much. Great, thank you. Moving on to our second agenda item, we will now have a presentation by the Right to Counsel Coalition on proposed city council legislation that would provide free counsel to qualified city residents who are facing eviction or foreclosure in housing court. There's a number of different folks who are presenting, so I'm going to ask everyone to come up and state your names for the record, and then I'll turn the microphones over to you guys.
Maybe we'll just stand since there's
Stand, you take the microphone off.
What's that?
You take the microphone off. Thank you.
Okay. So there's several of us here. I'm Andrew Scherer. I'm the policy director of the Impact Center for Public Interest Law at New York Law School. We're all active in the coalition.
Paris Martinez from University Settlement.
Chirac Lujapayla, Prior Community Council.
I'm Hyunjun Kim. I'm from Casa New Settlement Apartments. We're a tenant organizing project of New Settlement Apartments working in the Southwest Bronx area. So we have some handouts for you. Let me just quickly pass these around. Okay, thank you so much for having us here. We wanted to talk, we're from the Right to Counsel Coalition, which is a citywide coalition, and we want to talk to you about what this coalition's work is and why it's important. So as you may know, New Yorkers currently do not have the right to have an attorney with them when they're facing eviction in housing court. And some of the statistics that I will present to you, which are also in the handout, so you don't have to write these down, is that, in fact, in housing court, more than 90% of landlords who bring eviction cases do have an attorney. By contrast, only 10% of tenants have legal representation. Eviction cases are complicated, they move very fast, and they're highly technical. It's difficult, if not impossible, to defend an eviction if you don't have an attorney. The New York City Council is currently considering passing a legislation that would make New York City the first place in the country to establish a right to counsel for tenants facing an eviction. And that has the support of 38 sponsoring city council members, including 14 of the 16 city council members in your borough in Brooklyn. Right to counsel in eviction cases is about basic fairness and justice. due process, and equal protection of all people. Studies have established that when tenants are represented by an attorney, they're able to protect their homes. There are studies that have shown that about 50% of people who have been evicted would not have been evicted if they had an attorney represent them in housing court. Evictions, as you can imagine from your home, is devastating for the entire family. Last year, 30,000 families in New York City were evicted from their homes. This is a 20% rise from the past decade. Nearly 40% of people who end up in homeless shelters have identified eviction as a direct cause of them entering homeless shelters. So you can think about what this means currently with the homelessness crisis. There's an all-time record of homeless people, including about 25,000 children who are sleeping in homeless shelters. And this is an 87% higher than it was in January of 2002 when the former Mayor Bloomberg took office. Right to counsel is not only about fairness and justice and equality, it will also save the city money. So pragmatically, it makes sense. How would this save money? Well, for example, it would reduce the annual shelter costs. The cost that the city estimated of providing the right to counsel for these qualified tenants is approximately $1,500 per case. You could contrast that with the cost of providing a shelter, one bed per person per year, is $36,000. So it just makes, even just mathematically, pragmatically, financially, the responsible thing to do is to provide the right to counsel. That would save the city money in the long term. And then now, of course, and lastly, I'll mention that the rate of eviction is also having an impact on the availability and the preservation of affordable housing, because every time a person is evicted, there are loopholes that allow the rents to go up, and then you're contributing directly to the loss of affordable housing in the city, which is also a huge problem. So I'm going to turn it over to my colleagues, Andrew.
So we need your help. We have a large coalition. I think we have 70, 80 member organizations, housing advocates, community organizations, labor unions, religious organizations. But in order to make this actually happen, we need the support of the borough boards and greater popular support. It's a measure that will keep people in their homes and in their communities and preserve communities. It's a measure that will save money. The City Council Finance Division did a study and found that if the bill passed and we had a full right to counsel, that there would be $53 million a year saved the money spent on people in homeless shelters. It's a measure that would further fundamental fairness and due process. It's a measure that would send a strong message to the lowest income New Yorkers that their homes and their communities count. So we have passed around a resolution. I think it's really important for us to be able to answer your questions. So we want to use the rest of our time, whatever's left, to see what kind of issues, questions you may have, and take this up to the answer. Yeah.
What percentage of the evictions are from illegal apartments?
From illegal apartments?
Right.
I don't have that figure. We have somebody who may be here, you know, coming in here. The number of evictions from illegal apartments. It certainly happens regularly in court, but it's a fairly small percentage of the overall value.
Yeah. 30,000 evictions, they pretty much cannot afford to pay rent.
It really varies. There's proceedings that are brought against people because the landlord wants to take possession of the place. Is there for the landlord, for himself or for herself, claim that the tenant's a nuisance. Many of them for non-payment, but sometimes, actually many times, there are defenses to the non-payment proceeding. There's either a breach of the warranty patentability, or there's an overcharge. But the vast majority are brought for non-payment rent. It doesn't necessarily mean that the tenant owes the rent, and that's why people need counsel so that they can sort that out and not get wrongfully. And the studies have shown that about half of the people at least half, actually, some sites which are more, who have representation by council, are able to refer eviction. So it makes a big difference.
Last week, the mayor announced, I think, $12.3 million in assistance for legal services. Is there a cost savings? I'm trying to think about the right to counsel and the financial obligations that creating a right would bring, as opposed to providing the services voluntarily, and how the cost savings.
That's a great question, and I think it's fabulous that the city is now, that's $12 million on top of something like $32 million additional that the city's putting in. And that's great, and we, as the coalition, really welcome this. We're at a particular moment in time where we have a mayor who's interested in doing something like this. We have a city administration that's interested. But additional funding doesn't make a right. And if we were to establish a right, it would be a right that would last beyond one single administration. And the difference really is you cannot adequately target the legal services to make sure that you get everybody who might end up in the shelters. The only way you can do that is to blanket the whole system and allow everybody to have counsel when they need counsel. And there are lots of fundamental human rights questions at stake here, and it should be done even if it didn't stay. So the funding's great. It puts us in a position where the difference between what's already being done and what it would take to make it a right gets narrower. And we develop an infrastructure, and we train people, and we have the resources much closer to what we need. But it's not the same as the money. The funding could be taken away with the next administration or with the next fiscal crisis, and people will be left losing their homes without a reasonable opportunity to be heard.
For people that can afford rent, did you consider opening a Section 8 program?
Well, you know, the city is now reinstituting some rent payment programs. There's actually, I'm glad you asked that, because many times when people owe the rent, having an attorney enables them to advocate with the city agencies and actually private agencies as well that might enable them to pay the rent. So it's not always just simply defending against the legal proceeding. It's also the sort of ancillary advocacy that attorneys may be able to do to keep people in the house and get those resources. The city is reinstituting a program to help low-income people pay the rent, and that's great. But to navigate the bureaucracies, you need counsel, and certainly to navigate the court itself. Remember, these proceedings are summary proceedings. They're very quick, and the landlords have lawyers, and the ability to defend oneself and raise whatever rent you might have is virtually impossible to assert if you don't have counsel.
Any additional questions for members of the Borough Board?
So we'll be happy to come back and answer any questions after you've had an opportunity to look at the resolution at some future date.
Great. Thank you very much. Before we move on to our next two agenda items, I know we were joined by a few additional people. I see Community Board 3 represented, Community Board 6, Councilmember Barron has joined us, as well as representative of Councilmember Espinal's office. Has anyone else joined that is not here for the roll call? That's it, just those four? Okay, great. I'm just moving right along, guys, you see? Not that bad. Okay. Now we're going to have a presentation by the Department of City Planning, the first of two presentations. And I believe the first one we're doing is the mandatory inclusionary. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So now we're going to have a presentation by the Department of City Planning in consultation with the Department of Housing, Preservation, and Development regarding its proposed zoning text amendment for mandatory inclusionary housing. This text amendment is a key component of Mayor de Blasio's Housing New York plans to create or preserve 200,000 units of affordable housing. Utilizing the mandatory inclusionary housing program for the first time, New York City is proposing to mandate the inclusion and permanence of affordable housing in residential developments over 10 units, built within the individually rezoned areas. The requirement would work together with city housing subsidies, other zoning changes, and 421A reforms achieved in Albany this past legislative session. Winston Von Engel, Director of the Brooklyn Office of the Department of City Planning, will present and then answer questions from members of the Borough Board.
Thank you very much, Andrew. I just want to point out that I'm being joined by the Deputy Director of the Zoning Division, Frank Rushala, who will be presenting zoning for quality and affordability, as well as our two colleagues from HPD, Lin Zeng, Director of the Brooklyn Planning Office for HPD for development, and Brent Meltzer, Assistant Commissioner for Neighborhood Planning Partnerships. Okay, sorry. Thank you very much. Good evening, everybody. We're here to present to you two separate zoning text amendments that are going through the public review process. And the first one that I'm going to present to you is going to be mandatory inclusionary housing. And then Frank will go through zoning for quality and affordability. And so as a refresher, and I think the previous presentation was apropos why we are here today, which is that we have a housing crisis. And this mayor was elected in good part because people felt that there was a need to provide for more housing options, more housing choices, and especially for affordable housing. And so the measures that we're presenting to you are part of the city's, the mayor's housing plan to make it easier to build better quality housing and also to integrate our neighborhoods more economically on a case-by-case basis. So Housing New York is a plan to build and preserve 200,000 units of housing throughout the city through a variety of initiatives and policies that are to create opportunities to build and preserve for a range of incomes. This is why we're here. Right. There is a crisis in affordable housing. We are all fortunate here in this room, I presume, that most of us have a roof over our head, but other people are not as fortunate. We just heard that there is a homeless crisis. We're at almost 60,000 people. Those are individuals who are homeless, including many families. There are numerous waiting lists for housing, affordable housing, public housing. If those of you who are involved know about involved in affordable housing programs, you know how many applicants there are for each affordable housing unit. The demand is huge, and it is necessary. And it's a part of because we're successful as a city. Our economy is strong, our population is growing, both from people moving to our city, but also because families are growing in this city, and people are moving here, and people are families here, and children that are going to school, growing up, and want to stay in the city that they grew up in. So there's a gap between rents and incomes. Over the past decade, average rents have risen more than 10%, while incomes have not kept up. There is also very high rent burden. Rent burden is considered when you're spending more than 30% of your income on housing. And in fact, more than half of all New York City residents are rent burdened, paying more than 30%, and probably some here in this room, paying more than 30% of their income for housing. There is insufficient housing production. There isn't enough housing being built. You may think that you see all this housing being built, but it's still not enough to satisfy the demand of the population that is in this city. There's a limited supply of affordable units. There's only so much land that the city controls and that the city can subsidize in order to build affordable housing. So we must work with the private sector to maximize the amount of affordable housing in our city. And then finally, population growth. We expect that the population will grow by another 600,000 people in the next 30 years. That's not that we're opening the doors and say, please come and we'll have a campaign for people to come here. This is simply based on our own rates of births over deaths, plus our economy that is strong, that is attracting people to the city. That's a good thing. When I came to the city as a son of immigrants, we were at 7 million people. We have gained the population of Washington and Boston put together in this city over the past 25 years. you have to expect some change. So the Housing New York consists of three parts. The first one is to create more affordable housing. That is to create 80,000 new affordable units. That's through new construction, through HPD programs, to entice private developers, induce or work with private developers, not-for-profits and for-profits, to build more affordable housing on both private and city-owned land. It is to reform 421A, the tax exemption program, abatement program, to make it equitable, to allow more housing, affordable housing to be built, and to improve zoning to promote affordability. And that's what we're here today. To preserve existing housing and prevent displacement, and HPD is here. There, the experts, Brent Meltzer and Lin Zeng, are experts and have dedicated their professional work to doing exactly that, to preserve 120,000 units in the city, to strengthen rent regulations, and to protect tenants facing harassment. The mayor already committed over $30 million to a legal defense fund. And then it's to plan and invest for strong, economically diverse neighborhoods. And the first such plan that is being worked on is actually going to visit, we're going to visit you in a few months, and it's the plan for East New York. Right? It's a collaborative plan where we plan with the community, we're planning with the community, with stakeholders, with the elected officials for growth, for affordable housing, for economic development, and for our open space and community facilities in that community. So mandatory inclusionary housing. It is a zoning text amendment that was referred out by the Department of City Planning on September 21st, and is now for 60 days being referred out to every single community board throughout the city for 2 months. And it's for you to hold a public hearing and to issue recommendations to the City Planning Commission. And after that 60 days, it will go to the City Planning Commission for its consideration before it then moves on to the City Council for the City Council's final consideration. So what is mandatory inclusionary housing? Simply put, it's a proposal to use zoning to require permanently affordable housing when future zoning actions encourage substantial new housing. So what does that mean? It means it's a tool. We're asking for approval for a tool that in the future, when someone comes forward with a rezoning that increases density in an area, that they are able to be required to set aside a certain percentage of the housing in that building as permanently affordable housing, meaning for the life of the building. Not 20 years or 30 years, but for the life of the building. So the goals of the program are to promote vibrant and diverse neighborhoods. It is for economic diversity. It's not an exaction. It is not, we're not taking profit out of the developer's hands. This is not to skim off something. It is, we want a city that is economically diverse. We need a city that is economically diverse. We want to ensure that there is affordable housing in areas where we're planning for growth. I mentioned, you know, East New York. Other communities have also asked for similar studies that we're currently considering. Throughout the city, we have identified five other study areas in the Bronx, in Manhattan, in Staten Island, and in Queens. We want to meet the needs of a range of low and moderate income New Yorkers. This is not just the low income program. This is not just the moderate income program. It is supposed to be for a range. We're a diverse city. Everyone has a need. And then, very important, although it's last, the program has to meet legal standards. So it has to be applied consistently, and it has to support financial feasibility of housing creation. We don't want to create a program that simply stifles housing production, period, because that's not good. Even if you stall housing production, that doesn't help anyone. That just makes housing simply scarcer and more expensive. So the financial feasibility for mandatory inclusionary housing was based on a study that was done by a company called BAE Urban Economics. They're an experienced company in affordable housing that did the analysis
and that analysis concluded that there's a trade-off between affordability and lower income levels, right, in terms of the cost and the subsidy. They identified different housing markets throughout the city, from weak to strong, and you can imagine where those areas might be and in between. And they suggested or recommended that generally a requirement of between 20 and 30% was workable, depending on the income levels in most areas, if not all areas. In mid-markets, the markets that are sort of emerging, that are coming up, you need direct subsidy by our housing agency. In the weakest markets, and quite frankly, East New York is one of those areas where it is weakest, you actually need direct subsidy to make any housing, especially affordable housing, worthwhile. And finally, they examined a 50% requirement, and it was simply not financially feasible. The amount of subsidy, the amount of support needed for that would simply not be feasible. So here's some examples. There are three options being proposed. Actually, there are two options being proposed for a mandatory inclusionary housing. The first one is 25% of the floor area of a building at up to 60, or an average, excuse me, of 60% of area median income. Right, so 60% of area median income typically is about $46,000, $620, excuse me, for a family of three. Right, so that would be a paramedic's salary with two children, two dependents. Or it might be two people earning $20,000 and $23,000 or $26,000 a year, right? Relatively little, right? With a child. That would be 60% of area median income, and that is the average. So that some of the housing could be below, at 40% of AMI or 30% of AMI, so much lower than $46,000. And some of it could be higher, too, so long as the average was 60% or lower. The other option is 30%, so it's higher, 25 to 30%. And the AMI, though, is also higher. It's an average of 80% of AMI. So 80% of AMI is approximately $62,000 for a family of three. And that's, you know, a school bus driver, the example we give here, is a school bus driver and a home health aide. Two people earning maybe $40,000 and $20,000 a year, right, with a child. A dependent, trying to make a living in this city. Right? That would be the average, or slightly above or slightly below, so long, again, as the average was 80% of area median income and at 30%. There's also a third option that can be laid on top of or paired with option one and option two. And that is, so we call it a workforce option that allows 30% at 120% of area median income, which is about $93,000 for a family of three. And that sounds like a lot of money, and it relatively is. It's, you know, we put an example here of a firefighter or someone who's working for the city of New York, plus someone who's working in a restaurant as a server, right? That household makes about, or that family makes about 120% of area median income. One difference is the third option, the workforce option, as we call it, there's no public subsidy allowed. Right? Whereas the first two options, 25 and 30 at 60 and 80 respectively, you can use a public, you can use public subsidies from HPD, but with the third option you cannot. So it is a third option that can be applied when this is being considered. So the key features of the program are, in summary, that the required units need to be permanently affordable for the life of the building. It applies to new construction, it applies to enlargements, and it applies to conversions, and it's over 10 units. So whenever there are 10 or more units. The affordable units can be located on site, that is within the building that is being constructed. It can be done in a separate building, a clearly a separate building, next door or on another lot. that is completely independent from the ground, so there is no corridor. Or it can be done on an off-site on a different zoning lot, so long as it's within the same community district, or within a half a mile of the site. There's also another consideration for smaller sites, a payment in lieu option for projects that involve 11 to 25 units. And there is an escape valve, if you will. The Board of Standards and Appeals can hear appeals for projects that where the zoning would make the building, the construction financially infeasible. And so the Board of Standards and Appeals may grant a relief there. So the MIH works in concert with the other programs that I mentioned. So it works in concert with 421A reform, which the legislature finally passed this summer, and city housing subsidies by HPD, as well as zoning for quality and affordability that you're about to hear in a moment. So where are we now? As I mentioned, we just started the public review process 2 weeks ago. So we're about 15 days into the process. There is a total of 60 days that has been allotted for this text amendment for consideration by all the community boards. Our agency, as well as HPD, will be coming to every single community board, to your community boards. I know many of us have already scheduled meetings with us to come out and present this to you. This is the mandatory program will follow. It is a tool to be put in a toolbox. It is to be applied when rezonings occur around the city. So approving or implementing mandatory inclusionary housing as a tool does not mean that it is automatically effective in your district. It has to be applied together with the rezoning. And the first area where it is going to be applied actually with the rezoning is going to be in East New York. And that's the end of my presentation. I believe you wanted to open up for questions.
We're going to take some questions. But before we go to questions, I just want to lay out kind of a schedule. At the Borough Board over the next couple of months. We're going to have a public hearing on both this presentation and the following presentation at our November meeting. And then we're going to vote on a recommendation for these two proposals at our December meeting. That's in conjunction with the review that each individual community board will be taking over the next 2 months. So if your board has not yet scheduled these presentations with the Department of City Planning, please make sure you do so. Each board will have to consider and make recommendations on both of these applications as well. And then the idea is that our collective Borough Board resolution will reflect to every extent possible all of the combined input from each of the community boards over the next 2 months. And our process will culminate in December. So we're going to be revisiting this topic and the next topic both in November and in December on top of what you each individual board will already be doing on your own. Just want to lay out that schedule and that process for everyone. At this time, we're going to take questions on the Mandatory Inclusionary Housing Program. Councilmember Marin, we'll start with you.
Thank you. You indicated that the models were 25%, 30%, and 30% at 120% of the AMI. And then the models that you gave us a family with two parents and one child. However, if you look at the families in my community, that may not be the model. It may be one working parent with two children, which in fact then basically cuts the AMI in half of what your model is. So it's a bit of a problem to say that we're going to have housing that would be affordable when in fact the family of three that you're presenting as a model doesn't have two working parents in our community, in Community Board 5.
No, that's a very good point, Council Member, and I appreciate that. And we have considered the fact that there are in fact many families that have only a single parent or a single person earning income in that. And so, for example, you see actually under 40%, we have a security guard listed, so a typical security guard salary may be around $30,000 that would be 40% of AMI, or a paramedic at 46,000, right? So there are absolutely, this accounts for a variety of, we recognize that there are families obviously that are below that, and these are just examples of those standards. Just the fact that the average has to be 60% still means that's the maximum average, right? So it still can be much towards the lower end of the AMI.
And then the
city subsidies, especially.
Okay. The other point that you raised was the group that you mentioned said that 50% was not feasible.
That's correct.
And I offered to you that it's not feasible because developers have a sense of, I don't want to say greed, but excessive benefits.
Agreed.
And excessive benefits, financial benefits to what their investments are. And I suggest that that's the reason that the term is put out that it's not feasible. Not that in fact it is not feasible, but because developers want to target whatever that maximum return on their dollars is.
Okay.
Thank you. I have a question. We mentioned that affordable housing can be built off-site.
Yes.
Here you got the beachfront, half a mile away up the sewage plant. Mm-hmm. And that means the beachfront we built and the sewage plant is affordable housing? That's what we, can that happen?
Yes.
Wait,
yes,
sorry.
It'll be a wild time.
Yes.
Here you have two sites. It's the beachfront, waterfront, oceanfront.
Mm-hmm.
Half a mile away, you have the sewage plant.
Yeah.
Can affordable housing built on the sewage plant part? Yes.
No, because the sewage plant is a sewage plant and we wouldn't allow for affordable housing to be built on top of a sewage plant.
Let
it's also not zoned for housing, typically.
Okay, let me make a point more.
Yeah.
Okay. Next to sewage plant. Next door to sewage plant.
If there's, so, if the zoning, it's a tough question, because if the zoning allows for it, right, you can build affordable housing or market rate housing if the zoning allows it at whatever location, right? So theoretically, it is possible to build it, yes. But ideally, we would not want to see housing next to a sewage treatment plant. Although people are living, it's community district 15? Which community district are you in? 13, okay. Generally, the housing, when it is off-site, is done, if it is off-site, I mean, in your case, there's a sewage treatment plant. In other cases, we've seen housing being built in other locations where the zoning allows it from happening.
You mentioned that BSA could waive the requirement.
BSA can hear requests for reduction or whatever. There's a special permit that is proposed where BSA can, if the project can meet the findings and can show that there's a financial hardship, right, the essence of a variance, that the BSA can either reduce or waive the requirements.
And would there be a role for the city council member and or the community board in that waiver process?
I don't believe that with BSA waivers that they're, I mean, it's referred to the community board for its comment and recommendation, but there is that, and that's the process, right? It's a BSA process.
I have two questions. If the quality zoning affordability passes, then this is also passes, be able to implement this wherever the zoning changes. There would be a lot more areas that you couldn't use this that you would be able to.
Ryan, can you just repeat that? People in the back, could you pass
the
microphone? And actually, if everyone could just speak into the microphone so we can record your voices on the video, it makes it a lot easier when you put it online later on.
If the zoning for quality and affordability passes and the MIH passes, the MIH would be much more able to be utilized. There'd be many places where you could put it where you couldn't put it now. Because it would entail a lot of zoning changes. If they're both passed today,
right,
it would create a sea change for zoning and for building for affordable housing throughout the city.
Yes and no. The two work together, but in terms of being a sea change, remember,
In order for this to be actually implemented in your district, you actually have to vote for a zoning change in your district, right? Without a zoning change in your district, going from manufacturing to residential, going from a lower density residential district to a higher density residential district, such a discretionary zoning change, that's when the mandatory program would be applied. And that's when ZQA would also work together. But absent a zoning change, mandatory inclusionary housing is simply a piece of text in the zoning resolution, right? It's a tool that is at the ready for when there is a zoning change. If there is no zoning change, if the zoning in your district does not change, this does not apply.
And just about MIH, if these units are created, they'd be subject to rent stabilization of the units and every other ward.
They are subject to an agreement, a regulatory agreement with HPD as affordable housing for the length, the life of the building.
Just very quickly to sort of back up what Councilmember Barron was saying. I know that part of your presentation said that there would be no corridor allowed. So there's no corridor, but theoretically this could allow a fourth facility to be built, which seems a little bit hypocritical. I don't know if you've looked into that, and it kind of splits the quality and the affordability parts apart. Right. So I'd just like to know like how you would address some of those issues to prevent that from happening.
Well, we have buildings that are 100% affordable housing in the city and in Brooklyn, right? We have built those buildings. We have subsidized, as a city, we have subsidized those buildings. They're subject to review by the Department of Housing Preservation and Development. This would be a building that would be no different from such a building, right? It is subject to the same design standards that all other affordable housing has to go through at HPD. They have very rigorous standards. There are also very rigorous standards in the MIH text about the size of the units and the distribution of those units.
You had a question?
Yeah. Affordable housing is obviously meant for certain people to come. A lot of persons didn't go tremendously. What does that person get involved?
I'm sorry?
A person working the fire department. Becomes a captain or something, and his income is way above.
So if the income increases, yeah, that's right. What happens to their eligibility?
They're basically grandfathered in. They can remain in that apartment for as long as they wish to be there. They have to qualify for that apartment at the time that the apartment is made available to them. Right. So it allows it. You know, the one thing, I mean, that's a great question, right? Because the great thing about affordable housing is it gives a family some financial security that their housing costs will not increase. The rents will not increase beyond a percentage set by our housing agency, right? So it allows them to use whatever extra money that they gain through better employment to better their lives.
Something that's been discussed at CB2 a lot. Most of the units being built, whether the market rate or the affordable, because many of our buildings do left in the 2080 now for subsidies, but there's very few large apartments. There's mostly studios and one bedrooms, which in a sense, even the affordable unit, if you move in with the one child, as soon as you have another kid, especially a different gender, you need to get out. So you're going to lose your affordable housing simply because your family has grown,
right.
And yet there seems to be no incentive or push to have family-sized apartments. And this has been a gripe that we've had in CB2.
Sure. Right. So actually, mandatory inclusionary housing requires that at least half the units be two bedrooms, and a quarter allowed to be one bedrooms, and the remainder either studios or three bedrooms. So, good point. And in fact, you know, in some cases, we talked about the housing crisis and homelessness and people being on waiting lists. Many people who are on waiting lists for affordable housing are actually doubled up, right?
exactly in that situation. So that expresses the need for more. But MIH has a requirement, minimum of 2 bedrooms for housing units.
Doris?
Could you explain how the payment in lieu of affordable housing units would work? Who would administer it? How would the amount of units be determined? And how would the funds be used?
Okay. I can answer two of those three, right? So it would be administered by HPD, Brent himself, he has a page, he has a checkbook. I'm joking, but it would be administered by the Department of Housing Preservation and Development. The amount is yet to be determined, and I forgot the third part of the question. It was
how would it be used?
How would it be used? It would be used for new construction within the community district or for preservation. Right, so HPD would establish a fund that would be dedicated within that community district for a period of time, and it would be used to subsidize affordable housing in that district or to help preserve affordable units in that district.
Yes, question.
Just a little louder so we can get
yes.
you on the video.
Sure. If the mandatory it is tied to a deliberate zoning change for a specific community. So how do you see this fitting into your vision of a uniformly economically diverse city?
Well,
if the decision to change the zoning is being spearheaded or implemented by the community planning board themselves, choose it or not.
Correct.
How do you think that the end result is going to be a uniformly economically diverse city?
Well, that's up for us all to decide, right? I mean, that's why this is going through a public process for people to determine whether or not this is the right tool to do based on the facts, right, and the economics. And then when a rezoning goes through, it is up for the communities to decide whether or not they want this and which program they want it. Right? So it's, you know, if you, so it's for all of us to decide. But what it does is it establishes a minimum level of at least a quarter of the housing to be built on a particular site in an area that is being increased in density to be set aside for affordability for the life of development, to allow different economic levels, families with different economic levels, to live in that community as they do today in most neighborhoods.
And we have a clarification from each.
So it's also, it's not just public rezonings, it's not just rezonings.
It's just not rezonings that are instituted by the city, it's also private applications. So if a developer wants to increase the density on their own site, they would also, so in any part of the city that would happen, that would also implicate that. So that's one of the ways that it could actually, so it's not just in the places where being rezoned, but like in the Upper East Side, if someone wanted to build higher, they would have to institute mandatory.
Right. And I just want to point out, I don't know if this relates to your question, but it would be in higher density districts. So it's in districts that are generally R6, which is an apartment building district, and higher. It would not apply, it's not proposed to apply, it wouldn't apply, and wouldn't be feasible in districts that are low density. So 1 and 2 family districts or low density districts below R5 and below.
Yes?
Yeah.
I have a question regarding preservation of neighborhood character as regarding the MIH. And what we've seen in CB8 is R7D going up next to an R6B. And the development completely filling the lot. So for the two-family home that's on the opposite side of that lot line, they're now facing a brick wall, cheek to jowl. So I was wondering if there's any consideration in the rezoning text for side yards to mediate the clash between the lower density, which you call moderate density, R6, in this case, R6B in both instances, number of instances in CB8, where we have the higher density building going on, and the developer is totally insensitive to the people who already live there and will build to the lot line.
Okay. No, MIH does not have any provisions specifically to side yards or heights or density. It is merely a tool for economic diversity. It is not about side yards. So it doesn't change R7D regulations. It doesn't change R6B regulations. Zoning for quality and affordability does have some proposals, but I don't, and I'll let Frank talk about it when he presents zoning for quality and affordability.
Okay, go ahead.
I think even though this proposal is meant, it's to create new affordable units, there's a widespread concern that a proposal that encourages new market rate development is going to lead to displacement of existing residents, whatever that's based on. And you mentioned the study, the company that was engaged to come up with, to look at the housing markets in the city and come up with the targets. I'm wondering if there was anything in that study that looked at the impact on the housing market of encouraging development to this level for existing residents to try and mitigate that concern that a tool to encourage new market rate development and affordable development is going to lead to displacement.
Neither this mandatory inclusionary nor zoning for quality affordability are in any way, shape, or form encouraging further the development of market rate housing. There are no density increases proposed here, and there is no impediment. We don't think there's an impediment here, nor an encouragement of market rate housing. Having said that, one of the things that we need to do is to build more housing among all economic groups. The pressures that are being faced by communities like East New York, like Bedford-Stuyvesant, like Bushwick here in Brooklyn, is people moving from one neighborhood where it becomes not affordable to another neighborhood where it is affordable. And because people who have more money are moving in, if we create more housing at all income levels, we can try and reduce the pressure on rents. So establishing an apartment building is not in and of itself displacing anyone. It's simply a sign that people are moving into the neighborhood. The same people would live in that new apartment building, if they didn't live there, would live in the other buildings that are around it and that existed before that building. So, but first and foremost, this does not promote nor impede market rate housing.
Is there anything being done to offset the reduction of housing that I guess comes
more specifically to CB6? That we're consistently on the land use committee seeing the reduction of homes from what were three-family homes to one-family homes. Last week we saw two brownstones turned into that were six families to one family. Now, is there anything that's being considered to disincentivize that or something like that? I mean, I see it as a tremendous problem, and it goes against the grain of what the goal of this plan is.
Sure. No, this proposal, this tool, nor
that's alongside that specifically.
Right.
I wasn't seeking it out at this point.
No, the only thing I can say is that in neighborhoods where we're doing planning studies, we're working with our partners at HBD to empower tenants and encourage landlords, to the extent that they're not rent regulated, to abide by, to enter rent regulation and to protect the tenants against, inform them of their legal rights, as well as to help them if they're facing pressures from their landlord or landlady.
Okay.
Did you want to
ask? About transportation. The area is building, let's say you took building more housing, more people are coming in. Are you working with the MTA or the increased transportation?
Yeah. So we are in the neighborhood studies that we're doing, they all are along transit corridors. So for example, in East New York, you have actually five subway lines plus numerous bus lines plus a regional train line, the LIRR, traversing through that area. So we wouldn't want to, we are planning on purpose near transit because that's also what makes a neighborhood affordable, is if you reduce transportation costs. Thank you.
For a neighborhood that really doesn't have any vacant land, such as Community Board 7, along a transit corridor, are you looking at air rights to be obtained?
I know in Community Board 7, in Community District 7, we did a rezoning along 4th Avenue, and we actually applied the voluntary inclusionary program at that time. And to the extent that the developer can use air rights to build more housing, that can go forward. There's no proposal here to change those rules.
And again, CB7, because you've already had the rezoning, the mandatory doesn't come in unless you have an additional rezoning. And then potentially air rights could happen.
Just to follow up on the earlier question about the waiver for self-initiated zoning, where a waiver is sought partial or total for self-initiated rezonings. I mean, I say self-initiated rezonings, right, because, as you know, it's in the Community Board 14.
Right. I'm
concerned about the criteria for the waiver and whether those criteria are going to be set forth, the criteria that BSA will be using, whether they will be set forth and visible to the community boards and the council members.
Yes. It's not that when a private entity or a city entity applies for rezoning to increase density, and that they, at that point, with MIH, ask for a waiver. It is when a property owner who owns a piece of land that is, after it has been designated for mandatory inclusionary housing, for whatever reason, uniqueness of the property, dimensions, or whatever there is unique about the property, if they can meet the findings of the relief, at that point they can see if they can meet the relief. Your question is also, would those be promptly disclosed? Yes, absolutely. And it's in our text, it's basically financial feasibility. It has to be a hardship, to be financial hardship. And the BSA is actually very exact about making sure that there really is a financial hardship.
They will be in the text.
Yes, but you know what? I will look at the text, right? And we can all look at the text. It's online, and you can see for yourself.
Thank you.
Sorry. This is a little bit like, for example, there's a reduction that BSA can do for certain commercial uses to reduce the parking. So like you'll see there's a set aside of standards that will be in the text, and the question is, are these standards they're drafted, are they sufficient? We want to suggest things to punch up the text. That's something to think about.
Sure.
With all the plans and the lack of schooling areas to build new schools to, where are we going to put all of these children if we're not including schools in our plans?
Right, so that's an excellent point, right? So again, I want to repeat, right? This is merely a tool to apply at the time when you go through a rezoning, right? It's not like automatically now in CB7, if this is approved, you have MIH. You don't. You have nothing. Right? It's when someone comes, right, to you and says, I propose a rezoning to increase the density, to put more people, to house more people. At that point, that's when MIH comes into play, and that's when the schools question comes up. But I want to point out, where we're doing neighborhood planning, what?
We don't have rooms for them now. We're over.
Well, that's the current, that's right. We welcome the opportunity to plan with you. And it's, for example, in East New York, we are planning with the community for growth. There is some school capacity there, but there's also need for a school, right? So we're actually planning there with the School Construction Authority for a new school, right? It won't happen in every district, and it'll have to be, we have to make do with a much denser city. The people already here looking for housing, right? So it's a matter of where do we accommodate them.
This model was approved in East New York, right?
No. It's going through, so this is a tool
right? Basically, we're asking for approval of this tool to put it in a toolbox, right? So the next time someone goes for a rezoning, you say, here's the tool, you can use this, right, to do your rezoning. In East New York, they're already going through a rezoning, and we're saying, use this tool in the toolbox. And they're actually just,
they're if you're interested. They're offering us to use that. That's the recommendation that we use that.
Yes. And we're actually proposing the option one for East New York. It is to be decided by the City Planning Commission and ultimately by the City Council.
So if the City Planning Committee agrees on it and the City Council does not, and the Community Board does not, so where do we go from there?
Well, if the City Council doesn't approve it, it's over.
And if the City Council does approve it, does it require state action?
No. Again, if this is approved by the City Planning Commission and the City Council, it's a tool in the toolbox, right? It doesn't apply until someone says, I'm going to rezone, I'm going to increase density in a higher density district, and we're going to say, here, use this tool with it. Right? Not just the increase in density, but also ending the requirement for permanent affordability together with that.
Okay, and just for clarity, the Community Board, if we are not in favor of it, and City Planning and City Council agrees upon it, it will go into effect.
That's right. Technically, yes, but we would love the Community Board's support. And I know the City Council, and I'm sure the City Council, or I think the City Council, but also the City Planning Commission care very much about what community boards think, right? So we do look, we pass along every recommendation, and we try and we explain every recommendation, and they would like to hear from you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Problem we had, we were in CB2, we were already rezoned back in 2000. And obviously, you're proposing communities now to be rezoned. Now, once the communities are rezoned, and you do environmental impact statements based on what is at the time of the rezoning, and you project what the effects will be based on what you hope the rezoning will accomplish. Sometimes it doesn't work out that way. I know in CB2, our upzoning was upside down. We were supposed to get back office space, we got luxury apartment buildings. Now each developer comes and says, well, I don't have to do an environmental impact statement because I don't add 5% more to the schools. I only add 1.5% more to the school population. But there's 10 of these developers. So our population, we're at 140 capacity in our schools, and no one is doing an impact statement or anything because I don't have to, my one building only adds 1%. And this could happen feasibly in some of these other areas that you're rezoning. They don't always work out as you plan.
Right.
Is there any attempt or idea of taking a look back of what your policies have wrought?
Yes. Yes, there is. Right. So I know, Ms. Jenner, what you're referring to in downtown Brooklyn, right? And right now there's a proposal actually to, because there is capacity in some schools surrounding downtown Brooklyn to change the school zoning. But at the same time, the School Construction Authority, and that actually goes to your question as well, right? The School Construction Authority, each and every year, together with the Department of Education, scans for building permits throughout the city. They ask us for information about new housing developments that are going forward that we know about. And they build a list of where the needs are for new schools. And then they seek funding based upon that list. And they have a 5-year capital plan that they have. Now, it's not fully funded, right? We need more funding for that capital plan, right? And that's our tax dollars that need to be put into that to teach and educate our children and to find space for those. And so we are looking now in the city much more creatively at like, where can we build a school? So yes, we're working with the Department of Education, we're working with the School Construction Authority to come up with ways to put schools in areas that absolutely need them, and fortunately, hopefully, get the funding for them.
One more question on the permanent affordability. It sounds like these buildings will be registered to DHCR to monitor, registered to some regulatory agency to monitor that the rents being charged are the rents that the developer promised to charge. Will the developer, how is this tracking going to be set up? Does the developer have to pay a fee per apartment to register it the way it's done now? And if they don't, it just doesn't get into the database?
So it's not going to go into the database. I'm Brent, by the way. I'm HP, and I'm a lawyer, so I may always lean back to the legal side of things. It's probably not going to go into rent. We're still trying to worry about whether it will go into rent stabilization or not. But it'll be very, and we're also trying to figure out working on the monitoring system. It'll probably be very close to the voluntary inclusionary program, where we have nonprofit monitors who are paid by the developers to monitor and make sure that the rentals are, the rents are paid at what level. So that's generally how we've done voluntary inclusionary. That's what we're looking at. We're still tweaking that right now, so it's not exact. But it probably will not be overseen by HCR. It will probably be overseen by us. There is a possibility that certain aspects of it could be overseen by HCR. Everyone knows HCR, right, and rent stabilization. So there may be some aspects of that we could administratively use them, but we're still trying to work that out. It's sort of a legal question.
Thank you.
Sure.
I know Richard has a few questions to ask on behalf of the Borough President's office as well, so I'll turn it over to him.
So just clarifying, when you show the AMIs, obviously we could approach towards zero as the lowest that a developer might apply, but how high could they go within that range and still be considered meeting the affordable housing?
The highest they can go under MIH is 120%, right? But the average must be, for the option one and option two, the average must still be 80 or 60%, whichever option it is, or lower.
And with the 120, it's meaning every unit does not exceed 120, so all the units are very close to 120.
Correct.
So unlike some of the, for example, the affordable homeownership programs where they might range like 100 to 130 or 165%, you're drawing it very tight.
120%, no higher.
Okay, and then in terms of off-site, the preservation option is available for voluntary inclusionary. Is there a reason why the preservation option is not available to this? Because preservation keeps people from being pushed out of their homes, and if you're pushed out, it's very hard to meet the income tier. So just curious why that's not
right.
An option.
Right, so Richard is correct. In the voluntary optional inclusionary housing program that we have in many districts around here, there is the option to provide to preserve existing affordable housing in perpetuity. MIH does not have that option. It does not have that option because it is trying to, when it is applied, to encourage new construction of affordable housing. So to add, we have, again, I'm pointing towards HPD, a very aggressive, rigorous process of trying to preserve as much rent-regulated housing as possible, as well as to bring non-rent regulated units that are actually in a lot of areas, especially in East New York and other neighborhoods, lower density neighborhoods, to bring those into rent regulation and to protect them. But that's why offsite is not enough. Preservation is not enough.
And if it's the consensus of community boards and borough board and city council, would this be in scope to modify this tax to allow preservation?
I don't know.
Follow up and let us know. Thank you.
Certainly do that.
Yeah, and then last question. Certain rezoning proposals that the agency would make put forth or that private developers may put forth may have various ranges like a 50% upzoning or a 200% upzoning.
yet it seems like you have a one-size-fits-all, so you did have one slide towards the end mentioning about some issues there, so just want to clarify why we're doing one-size-fits-all, regardless of the job.
Right. It's for legal reasons. This is not an exaction. This is not, we are not skimming off the profit of the developer. The goal here is for economically diverse neighborhoods. So we're not going to increase the percentage. We cannot increase the percentage by more than 25 or 30%.
Okay, last question.
Just try to be clear about one thing. Here you have a beautiful high rise, but water, front doorman, you know, pool. Here you have the affordable housing part. Found in the cheapest part of the zoning within half a mile radius. Here's the cheapest piece of land you can find, half a mile away. Now you have 10, 20 years pass by, this building gets maintained, cleaned, this building falls apart. What happens, I mean, and you know what, in about 20, 30 years, what happens if the developer just walks away, walk away from his house? You know what, the city take over this. I don't want this. I want this beautiful high rise.
Right.
The money is. I don't want this.
So the way it works is that the certificate of occupancy with a beautiful luxury high rise with a swimming pool and doorman is tied to that affordable housing development. Right? It becomes non-compliant the moment that other building, the affordable housing, is no longer there. Right? And we have our we want to make sure that that housing actually stays affordable and stays on the books and is maintained well. Unfortunately, in New York City, we actually have a good experience of preserving affordable housing, right? So yes, there is that danger, but the owners of that of the luxury development would be putting their building at risk by letting the other building go to pop. Now, remember, the affordable housing development has to work, and that's why we're getting into this discussion, this back and forth. It's 50% feasible, it's 25% economically feasible, right? The reason why we did the study, we wanted to make sure that that affordable housing continues to be financially feasible, right? People need to pay some amount of rent to maintain the building, otherwise it just becomes, you have to increase the subsidy permanent, you have to have a permanent subsidy, operating subsidy for that building, right? These buildings are being built together with tax credits and other means, 421A, that allows them to stand in financially feasible in perpetuity, managed by a reputable affordable housing manager, right? So we look very carefully at those numbers, and you know, HPD does, because they don't want to see that from happening. But it's also in the interest of the luxury housing to make sure that that affordable housing stays, because otherwise it impinges on their ability to refinance or actually occupy the building.
Last question, last
one. Yes, just as a follow-up. Can the owner sell it after 30 years? And what is the obligation to the new owner to maintain that property?
Permanently affordable. So when someone buys that luxury building after 10, 20, 30, 50, you are bound by that affordable housing. It's, yes.
Say that because, yes. Very interesting. I found out that into perpetuity does not mean forever and ever. The state changes. So it sounds great, but into perpetuity does not always mean forever and ever.
In this case, it's for the life of the building.
Okay. Are you going to enforce it?
Well, you do it through the certificate of occupancy. No, it's a certificate of, in the certificate of occupancy and other means that there is, and there's a, what's that? I'm sorry. So partly through the certificate of occupancy.
So for the permanent, the way I think it's going to work is there's going to be a restrictive declaration put on the land. So it actually runs with the land and the building there. So if the building gets sold, any title company would see that restricted declaration on the property itself and the land. So that's how it would be permanent. And in order to get your certificate of occupancy from the Department of Buildings, we'll be flagged about that. So we're still working on the exact mechanics, but that's the way it generally would work.
Okay. So we're going to switch gears here. I think we got a lot of questions underway. Again, city planning, if they have not already, will be presenting this to each individual board. So if you do not get a chance to have your question answered, or you have questions that develop over the next month or so, you'll have a chance to address it with them at the board level. And then again, the Borough Board will consider this at a public hearing in November, and then a vote in December. So we'll have a chance to engage in this conversation again over the next 2 months. Now we're going to have a presentation by City Planning regarding its proposed zoning text amendment for zoning for quality and affordability. The zoning for quality and affordability text amendment aims to address zoning regulations that are outdated and often impede and discourage the production of better quality residential buildings and the creation of a wider range of new affordable housing. This proposal is tailored to address issues specific to different neighborhood contexts.
Great. Hello, everybody. My name is Frank Michalla. I'm the Deputy Director of Zoning for the New York City Department of City Planning. Similar to, as Winston described before, the Mandatory Inclusionary Housing Program, Zoning for Quality and Affordability began the public review process just a few days ago. And it will be coming to your community boards. Our borough planners will be coming to give presentations. But we wanted to make sure that borough board had the opportunity to see the version of the proposal and be able to try to answer as many questions as we could today to make it easier when you have a review with your community boards over the next couple of weeks. I know we came here, I was looking back, it was in March, it was very cold and snowy that day, but the department came to give a presentation to you all about the proposal as it was kind of initially proposed. We had a lot of good discussion about it. We've come to your community boards in the summer, basically May and June, to go over and give an information session to almost all of the boards in Brooklyn, I believe, to just go over it, have some conversations about it. We've made some changes to the proposal reflecting some of the things that we've heard in all of those conversations. So this is, for us, unlike the mandatory, which is kind of a brand new topic, the way that we think about this is that you all probably heard much of this. We just want to make sure, though, that you have the opportunity to answer any questions that you have. So, zoning for quality and this part. We've made some changes, and I think that's something we've talked about as we've gone through this, and I think you've heard about a number of those changes. We've tried to provide as much information to community boards, elected officials, as possible about where the proposal would have effects, what those would be. And have continued to try to get out to all community boards that will be out over the next couple months to try to answer as many questions and try to come up with ways to make sure that the proposal and we can hear its goals can meet those goals and can meet your goals too. So that, I think, is where we're at.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. We're going to open up to questions with the caveat that I know last time we did this presentation there was a lot of concern about some of the points that were made. If we can limit our questions to actual questions about the presentation and not statements about parking requirements or height requirements, things like that, statements we'll save for next month at the public hearing, both for the public and for members of the Borough Board. So if there are technical questions about what was just presented, we'll entertain those questions now for the board.
Whenever you show the ground for the attractive, you always show commercial in a residential building. But if it's not zoned for that, what do you place?
So this, and I tried to show it in this drawing, but let me just describe it again. It's an issue that we see actually in both. We see it as an issue, it makes it hard to provide retail space, and it also, in a lot of respects, the rules are basically forcing the ground floor to be where the building starts, where the kind of unit starts, and so everyone kind of sees each other at eye level. An older building actually would raise that ground floor slightly. A foot, a 2 foot, something like that. So what we've tried to do is in those instances, you have the ability to get the flexibility to provide, to effectively raise that ground floor the same way you would have providing a taller ground floor for a retail space. So we think that it works for both types of conditions. So in a residential street, which is I think something that we've spent a lot of time trying to think about how we can do, the idea is that we're in the existing, that we know when that ground floor is really at eye level, that the proposal would allow you to raise that ground floor like an older building used to, so that you don't have that kind of high level relationship. And I think that's the idea. So in a retail street, it's retail. We hope that works. We want to make sure that retail works. It's something that we've actually been quite surprised at. We've heard from HPD, we've heard from architects. communities want retail in their buildings, and then what they find is the zoning is actually making it hard to do. We want to make sure that you can build retail in a building when it's permitted.
Is there any legal restriction on allowing developers to reduce parking for affordable units in transit corridors, but also requiring them to give equal access to both affordable and market rate tenants for the parking spots that are created?
So there's no legal requirement. As we understand it, what happens in a building is per zoning, when you're building a building, you have to meet certain parking requirements. You have certain amounts that are required for whatever number of units you have in the building. Those then are built. Then what happens are, there's no requirement that that parking space be for that tenant. Most of the parking requirements, and this is actually important to remember, in the medium and high density areas of the city, most of the parking requirements are actually less than one parking space per unit. So it's not like a one-to-one relationship. Already, it's smaller numbers than that. So that amount exists, and then that amount is then kind of able to be rented to the tenants, or kind of given to the tenants as part of their tenancy. What we've seen, though, is that when an affordable housing tenant, say, is zoning requires the parking space, the tenant, and it's a particularly structured parking, right? Like, so in a medium and high density area, it's typically underground or in like a garage kind of facility. The costs to construct that parking space are so high that the costs to rent that parking space are prohibitive to a low-income tenant. So what happens is a low-income tenant, if they do have a car, don't tend to park in the spaces that were required of them by zoning. They instead park on the street because it's more efficientness, cheaper for them than it would be to try to pay what are the high rates necessary to meet that construction cost. Does that?
The parking spot is about 8 feet by 20 feet. It's 160 square feet, whatever it is. If you lose about 10 parking spots, how many are you getting another apartment for? If you lose 10 parking spots, you're getting another unit, another
I think the way that we put it is less, it's not like a one-to-one thing, but it's simply when the city is effectively helping subsidize or pay for affordable housing, right? And if the cost of making that project work include parking, and that parking is $30,000-$50,000 per space, that is an amount that the building and that affordable housing is really being asked to bear. So it isn't so much emptying this amount of parking amounts to this much housing. It's more like, in total, it means there's more money available for affordable housing than there is for parking.
But I can tell you that there are many affordable housing developments where the parking is done at grade. They were underbuilt because that was the maximum amount of units they can get based on that's all the parking they can fit affordably. So this proposal would allow the full floor area to be utilized by many more affordable housing sites moving forward.
I just want to clarify something. The 5 foot additional height given or made available if one builds the ground floor 13 feet high, that's an incentive on top of whatever additional height it takes to get the 13 feet, right? So you have, if the existing ground floor is 10 feet and you're going up to 13 feet, that's 3 feet additional height, and that would be 5 additional feet on top of the three?
It's just five. It's
just five.
Yeah.
So what's the incentive to a developer to do that?
Well, I think what we've tried, it's not so much an incentive to do that, it's that today something is offering a disincentive from doing that, right? So we're trying to actually create a level playing field so that when one wants to provide retail, they can provide retail. When one wants to raise the ground floors from a residential building, for example, they can. For today, it's the opposite. One of the things that we've been quite struck by is it's actually the opposite. There's a lot of times where zoning is actually offering an impediment to doing the things that I think we all reasonably want.
Can I follow up on Alvin's question?
Yeah,
sure. Wi-Fi feed to me, if you want to add a flow, building, you're going to need more than 5 feet. So
It's a good question. We spent a lot of time looking. So our rules really have been in place for about 30 years. We've had a lot of experience seeing buildings built under them. Architects have had a lot of experience designing under them. We've seen just a lot of buildings around. So we've spent a lot of time looking at our zoning rules. It was the first time we did it comprehensively since about 30 years ago. We tried to look at what best practices are for retail spaces, for residential spaces, and how do those work in buildings. And what we found was, for the most part, and again, this kind of speaks to the original rule, which is most of these rules work. There's just these certain moments where it actually makes a part of ground floors is one of those areas. Where what we felt was we didn't need to increase more for the rest of the building. You had the height you needed. You just didn't have the height for a ground floor. So we've tried to look at those issues, find those places where zoning was impacting as an impediment to a good building, and change that, and not give more flexibility than just to do it. Try to be more sensitive to it.
Yeah.
How do you envision the
speak up a little bit more, sorry.
How do you envision that the raised first floor plate in residential resolves with handicapped accessibility? Are you relying on inclined lifts and all?
So this is a really good, this is something that we've tried to address also. I didn't get... Okay. So this is it's a very good concern, which is that if we've raised, or if we've allowed for the raising of the ground floor unit, how does someone access that unit? And this is showing in our 6B building. There's only arguably one unit, but there's larger buildings where this would happen, and there could be a whole floor of that. So what we've tried to do is, when you have an interior that actually gives you the height needed to actually get to that raised ground floor, we would allow that ramp to be discounted from floor area so that you're given the ability to actually provide that ramp. So we're trying to we're trying to address accessibility issues for when they're doing this. We recognize this problem.
And the second thing I wanted to ask is just if I've heard before.
Sure.
I think what I heard you say is that there's all affordability is not increased flooring. It just increases the quality limitation, if you will, so that the floor area can be otherwise distributed in that maximum box. But there is no increase in the floor area.
There's no increase in market rate floor area.
And so
like what that, let me describe what that is. So there's a lot of rules, and this is speaking for about affordable senior housing and care facilities. There's a lot of rules today that actually make it harder to provide. You get the ability to provide a higher FAR, but you have various actions that actually kind of make it harder to do. And so today in zoning, you're required to require special permits, authorizations, things like that, to get that floor area that you're already provided. So one of the things we're trying to do is make it easier and making it more as a right to build those facilities. So we're trying to be as truthful and honest as possible, is that arguably one could say that is an increase in floor area for affordable senior housing or a care facility. But from just regular housing, market rate housing, it's all changed.
For the senior, they're eager, they're about to be difficult on testing, you're enjoying the same increases in floor area or additional increases in floor area beyond what is already given?
So for affordable senior housing today, you're already given a higher floor area ratio. This is really, it's kind of ironic in many respects. You're just not given a way to fit.
Right. So I'm asking if this text change gives more floor area.
I think outside, we don't think it gives any market rate floor area.
There's a couple of ways the proposal creates more floor area. For example, the existing Catholic charity buildings, if they are able to remove their parking, many of them are underbuilt based on the existing floor area. This will create an area where they can place some volume and build floor area that we don't have today. We also have lots, say, that are shallow. So even though the zoning gives you floor area, you can't fit them in because of other zoning parameters. So this will create additional floor area. This is, in the scheme of New York City, it's a very nominal percent. And the last way this gives floor area is we may get more developers to use the voluntary inclusionary program. So that's a little bit of market, a lot of affordable. affordable. So those are the three areas it creates for a floor area, but it's really minuscule in the scheme of the whole.
And again, those are examples that you cite for spillways of utilizing the current floor, not actually changing
that,
it.
And that's, we're letting you use floor area that without these changes, we're not going to get to on certain properties.
Thank you.
That's what you did. Sorry.
Yeah, I want to clarify something. Affordable for seniors, chain breaker affordable, there will be no zero requirement for any parking at all.
So let me try to just go through that. So affordable senior housing, which today is a type of housing that has an income restriction and an age restriction as part of the proposal. If you're in, you mind if I just go back, or try to just go to the map just to, if you're in that area where you've designated the transit zone and you're building a facility, you would not be required to provide parking. Similar actually today in downtown Brooklyn, there in the special district there, you're not required to provide parking for affordable housing. So basically extend that to a wider area of the city.
Yes?
Will the opportunity for developers to build voluntary inclusionary housing remain on the books?
The voluntary program will continue to exist. All the proposal does is really says, we give you a higher floor area, but we don't give you a place to put it. So we're going to give you a place to put that floor area. But the program itself will continue.
The voluntary program will continue.
Right, those places.
Even though we've seen that it doesn't really return the number of affordable housing units.
Well, I think
that are promised by the developers.
Well, I think to be honest, I think one of the things that we've seen is what we've seen as part of the areas that we've created inclusionary housing areas is that sometimes the program is used, sometimes it isn't. And there, when we look at, we try to say, how can we make sure that the program is used when we thought that it would be? Right? And so one of the things that we were struck by is it's hard to fit the floor area in the building envelope, right? You just can't. So many people don't take advantage of it. And this is something that we're very cognizant of. We've had conversations with communities that this program would provide affordable housing, but the building envelope, after the zoning had passed, is actually becoming an impediment to the creation of that affordable housing. So we're trying to correct that.
This is more of a suggestion than it is a question, and it's a suggestion to Borough Hall. There are whole areas that we weren't able to cover while in zoning quality and affordability, such as the redefinition of nursing homes into the category of long care senior housing. And I'm asking Borough Hall to focus on this and explore the ramifications of the definitional change. Because one of the changes that appears to be present is that the requirement that nursing homes go through a city planning commission special permit process, which triggers a public review, would be ended because city planning is asserting that the state's typical lead process covers those issues, but it doesn't seem to cover hyper-local zoning issues, revealing traffic problems, parking problems, inconsistency in land use at the local level. So because of that, I'd like Borough Hall to focus some attention on this for future time.
Well, with your questions, I have a few questions actually that may tie into that a little bit.
I just wanted to visualize what you were saying. If this was a good thing, in a neighborhood, you see a house that's 5 feet taller than everyone else's, and if I live behind that house, you rob me of my sunshine. So I'm thinking in terms of the visual, you know, if it is an advantage to having that eyesore pop out of a conventional buildings, and then all of a sudden you're walking down the street and you see, say, how is that possible? But if you live behind that building, your whole visual has been disrupted.
So I think what we've tried, we're very sensitive to neighborhoods, and under these rules, there's a height limit, and people are very used to that height limit, and so we're trying to be very cognizant of that, really kind of point out that there's a trade-off.
I can't hear you very well.
Sorry, that there's a trade-off, which is, we have height limits today, I'll use the R60 example, which are making it hard to provide a good ground floor area, right? So when you walk by the building, you may not have retail, it is good of units or kind of shades are all drawn, and that, the way we see it, and I think the way that we've kind of heard it from communities, is that that's a concern they have about new buildings. The trade-off is, to fix that, what we found that we needed to do was provide flexibility to make the building slightly taller, 5 feet taller, to address that issue, right? So we've tried to tie those two things together. So if you don't get a taller ground floor through this proposal, you just get a normal ground floor you would have gotten today, the building gets no taller. If you did get that ground floor raised so that you would have retail space for if it's permitted there, or just a raised residential ground floor, the building does get a little taller, 5 feet, but it allows for that experience when you walk by the building, which is the way we all as the public kind of really engage with buildings, that experience would be better. And we've tried to do, and this is something that we have lots of examples of, trying to show what that looks like at street level. So this is the building today. This is the R6B building that you can build under zoning today that has that ground floor, and that's low. That's kind of right at street level. The proposal does that. That's the difference in the change. You saw it kind of slightly increased the height. That's the total of the 5 foot change.
Right. And slightly, it was noticeable.
It's not, I'm not saying it's not
noticeable. That is uniform. Here, it was like an albatross.
I would say that in many of the areas, we've tried, when we look at the areas where we have zoning in place, it's not so clean cut across. There's some taller buildings, there's some shorter buildings. This tries to make sure that when you have a new building, it can be good at the ground.
No, Richard has a couple of questions to ask on behalf of Borough Hall. I'll turn it over to him.
Okay, so dealing with the lower density neighborhoods, especially in terms of nursing home, but also for the seniors. So we've had zoning tools put in place for 28 years, lower density tools, but we've only had a few neighborhoods mapped, like Bay Ridge, Diker, Canarsie, the eastern part of Bensonhurst, Victorian Flatbush, Midwood Homecrest, and Plum Beach got some of these fine grain rules. We got a lot of R32, a lot of R4, a lot of R5 there, yet the homes seem to be more reflective of detached and semi-detached homes, so any consideration in terms of the nursing home, the envelopes, in terms of giving consideration where the areas look more like the R4A districts that allow detached instead of multifamily buildings.
So the proposal today, just to kind of give some background to that, proposal today tries to reflect what zoning already is doing, which it says you have a higher permitted floor area if you're providing affordable senior housing in R32, R4, and R5. You just don't have an envelope for it. You've got a cap at a height limit. And to change that, they'll be able to build a building with the use in it. You have to go to the City Planning Commission for proof of that height. This makes it harder and cheap and makes it more costly and takes longer to build affordable senior housing facilities in these neighborhoods. And so what we've tried to do is say, to better promote the facilities, we will create an as-of-right envelope for that use and that use only in these neighborhoods, really reflective of what gets built under those zoning districts. So this is generally a 4 to 6 story apartment building for affordable senior housing. So one of the concerns that we've heard from a lot of people is, are those heights appropriate? For the lower density parts of that, R32, for example, as opposed to R5. So there's different maximum floor areas you're given, but the envelope that we proposed was the same. So as part of the EIS, we actually looked at an alternative that actually lowered the maximum height in the R32 to kind of be more reflective of the FAR. But I think this is something what we're trying to do is make it easier to build these facilities in our lower density neighborhoods, but we're willing to continue to try to work to try to make sure that that goal doesn't cause concerns with other goals that people have had about how it would affect their neighborhood.
Okay, and then in terms of the height issue, right now with the inclusionary, if you don't build the affordable housing, you get about 15% less floor area than non-inclusionary districts, yet they both have the same height. Is there any reason you're keeping them both at the same height despite about a 50% difference in floor area?
I mean, I think just generally the proposal, and it kind of speaks to its original goal, which was to make it easier to build affordable housing. And so the proposal tried to address those things and we're making it hard to do that. I think the idea that you're raising about lowering heights when you're not providing affordable housing is something that's just not in the proposal. But it's something that as we're looking at volunteer program in the future or other things we've been trying to look at. I would note though, what we found is when you have that even lower floor area, because the envelope can be difficult to type, you're still getting examples where the buildings really are kind of flat boxes. So it's lowering it even more may just amount to more flat box buildings, but that's something that we can continue to look at.
And again, when you mentioned the height, so just to be clear for those who haven't read the text yet,
yeah.
In R32, R4, and R5, the height is 60 feet. It doesn't matter, even though the R5 allows double the floor area of the R32 right now. That's what's proposed.
And again, just to that point, and again, just to make sure you understand why we did that, which is we looked back over like the last 20 years of the types of facilities that were approved by the commission and what did they look like. They were generally the range from 4 to 6 story buildings. And so we tried to address the 6 story version of that, so it would be a fully as of right envelope. But we understand that as well.
Okay. Any other remaining questions? Right.
So in the low density district, sure. These envelope changes and height changes, they would apply the C2A that we got by the city council.
So if one was built, so if in a low density, and this is really the only kind of change when we're talking about low density districts. So all of that stuff in the quality portion was R6 or R10. But this here was an issue that we saw. It was really an impediment to providing affordable senior housing in lower density parts of the city. So what we tried to do is if the proposal passes, this envelope would be available if affordable senior housing was being proposed. I would note it as a form of housing, this is really only developed when the city subsidizes it. It is not a kind of market rate type of housing. This really requires a lot of services and a lot of funding to make work. So it's limited in how much.
Does it have to be completely affordable senior housing or can it be any mixture of other?
I think as it's generally written today, it says if you have it in the building, but it's a fair point. I think we can look at that more.
Any last questions?
Last question. Frank, how do you spell your last name?
Rachala. R-U-C-H-A-L-A. It's been a long day and there's no water.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. So again, just a reminder, we're going to have a public hearing on this and the last presentation in November, and then a vote with the recommendation from the Borough Board in December, in addition to what each individual board will be doing over the next 2 months. Additionally, as you know, all of our meetings are taped according to city law, and they're put on the Borough President's website as well as the Borough President's YouTube page. Once we upload this video from tonight's meeting, I will send out the link to all the board members. Please share it with the other members of your community boards if you think that they will benefit from hearing this presentation, again, in addition to what they're going to be hearing at their own respective boards. Do any members of the Borough Board or the representatives have any old business to discuss? Nobody? No one else? Just sitting here and talking with the calendar? Do you have any new business to discuss? No new business, okay.
Move to adjourn.
Our next meeting, before we do that, will be Wednesday, November 4th. Wednesday, November 4th at 6 p.m. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Yes.
Is there a second?
Yes.
All in favor of adjourning? Are you guys sure?
Okay.
All right, have a good night, everybody. Thank you.